When I Google Twin XL, it's just nothing but mattress promos.
I know.
Were you inspired by mattresses for the name of this project?
Really, the only reason we called it Twin XL is because Queen was already taken.
So it is a bed pun.
It's a bad bed pun. She said she needed an upgrade. Got some places to go. She needed her own space to bring a new one home. And I said, okay, do whatever you want. Do whatever you want. Yeah, yeah.
Dude, good to see you. Thanks for stopping by. Frankie, are you going to come up here? No? Please, all right. No. I got the dog here. Come on up. Come on up. Join us. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Oh, there she's not coming. Well, all right.
You're still invited, Frankie.
Well, you're still invited, Frankie. My dog is down here if anybody wants to know what I'm trying to do. But first thing I have to say, okay, apparently you like the guests more than me. So we'll be taking you to the pound after
it's
this, Frankie. This is Frankenstein. I'm trying to incorporate her into my interviews, and she's slowly but surely behaving better.
Sweet. I met her when she was very small.
Oh, yeah. You came in here with Jordan.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you guys were in here. So what's your history with Jordan? That's how I first found out about you.
History with Jordan.
Yeah. So because I first knew you when you were doing stuff in Ready Set.
Yeah.
And then you guys did Nekokat after that.
Uh-huh.
And bring me full circle with how that all came to be.
So I had a project, like a solo project called Weather Star in my early MySpace era. And I had signed to the same management company as the Ready Set.
Mm-hmm.
So us being friends was like a total like arranged thing. It was like, I think he had a show at House of Blues or something. And our manager was like, "You come back here and meet Jordan." And we just kind of, we were both really, we're still pretty awkward people or reserved. But we literally just sat on a couch and I was like, "Hey, dude, like I like your music." And he's like, "Yeah, I like your music too." And that was it. And then we didn't see each other for however many years. And his bass player left the band. So he texted me and he was like, "Hey, do you want to come and ride in a bus instead of a van and play awesome big
up.
Shows?" And I was like, "Yeah." So, yeah, that's how we met. And then we started writing together pretty quickly after I joined his live band. And then we eventually started. We lived together for a while in a house, and
you guys got married. I mean,
we
the
got
story
married.
Just goes
it's
on
just
and
yeah,
on and, on.
And so yeah. Now, honestly, like we do so much stuff together. This outside stuff for other artists. It's like, yeah, we just have that mental connection thing that happens, where like we can be writing a song with someone else, and like I already know what he's gonna do or say before I.
So you guys
say
are
it,
on
so.
The same wavelength a lot in regards
yeah,
to the creative
just,
process.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it just like works.
And then Nekokat happened.
Nekokat was like a fun thing. Yeah,
with Jess.
With Jess. Yeah, we actually all lived in the same house. It was chaos.
Was that before the project started, or were you guys
it
just living
like
in the same house? And then you're like, well,
after.
Let's make music.
It was shortly after the project started, and we didn't really. It's funny, like people still, like even when I was on tour with Twin and stuff, people would show up with Nekokat shirts that I didn't even know existed. And it is kind of cool that for a band that played three shows.
I was about to ask, what was the longevity of that? Because it was a pretty quick thing.
We played like a couple shows, and we put out a good handful of music. And what always ended up happening was as soon as we'd be like, okay, we're going to go like really try
full
to tour
force.
Or something, the Somerset would be like, well, we're back together again. Or, Jordan would be like, oh, I just got this tour offer. So we're going to go do that. So it just kind of never came to full fruition, I guess. But, people really like the music and I like the music, and it's kind of like this cool little time capsule now of something that we did that was just purely for joy.
And then, because Jess from Somerset said she was in that, and then comes Twin XL, which has John and Steven
right.
from Somerset as well.
Right.
Where did that relationship come from
like
to kick
the whole
off that
thing,
project?
The whole thing is like this weird like like set thing, you know? I mean, I actually met the Somerset in like 2000, like, 8 or 9 or something.
Oh, wow. Maybe so that goes way back.
Way back.
When you guys met.
And just from being around shows and, like, playing in my other bands and stuff. And I guess I just knew him forever. We would hang out here quite a bit or run into each other. And me and John and Steven would always be like, we should totally get together at some point and make some music. And then after just you know, blowing each other off for however
years
long.
And years.
It just eventually we did, and then I think the first song we wrote was "Good," which ended up being our first single.
Oh, you have no idea. Tommy and I, we whistle that song so much. And
I actually can't whistle.
What? So that was not your whistles in the song?
It's John.
Oh, my God. I those are some beautiful whistles. But we specifically sing to Frankie, and we just go, Frankie, Frankie, Frank, Frank. And I'm not, if you knew how often we do that, it's embarrassing. And one time we were doing it upstairs, and you were downstairs for something with fish, and we didn't realize it. And then I came back up, and I was like, Tommy, we got to stop. Cameron is downstairs right now, and we are about to embarrass ourselves.
That kind of happens whenever I work with, like, an artist that I was previously a fan of.
Yeah.
And it's always such a cool experience. Like, it's always been good for me. I've never, like, been like, man, I really wish I didn't meet that guy. But, like, this thing happens where in my head, I'm just singing whatever the song is. Mm-hmm. And I'm, like, trying so hard to, like, not,
to not
tap
say it out
the
loud.
Drums or, like, yeah.
What was that?
Yeah.
And when I got, like, when I finally got, like, my new professional camera, video camera back in 2018, I think your show was the first thing I ever filmed on it. If you remember back in December 2018.
It was, like, our first or our second Twin XL show, but it was, like, kind of like our showcase.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to remember the words to our songs. So I listen to them on my phone, and then I forget them anyway, so it doesn't matter. Green lights, 90 degrees with the
top down. Straight lines. Yeah, that was awesome. That video I remember, did a lot for us. Like, that, like, helped.
You hear that? I'm here to make
secure
careers.
Our record deal and all that stuff.
Did it really? Because it was a great crowd.
It was kind of like, it reminded me of, like, you remember back in the day, bands used to make EPKs?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It was kind of like an EPK.
Uh-huh.
And it showed that, like, wow, if this band plays a show, there's going to be some people there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, like, that's really all you need.
That's sick. I didn't know that. Yeah, so that's awesome. Because that was so fun for me to just try out the new camera and do that edit. So that was cool. Hell yeah. I'm happy to hear that.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. And I'll take full responsibility for Twin XL. And then of this pandemic, the world's been shut down for mm-hmm. 2 years. But it seems like you keep busy because you haven't put out Twin XL stuff.
We've been putting some music out. We were working on an album throughout the duration of the pandemic.
Yeah.
A lot of the songs were written before the pandemic. And then we kind of just recently, we know what's on the album and it's mastered and it's, like, ready. We're just kind of waiting for the machine to
mm-hmm.
you know, kick in with the label stuff. But yeah, and then I just write for so much other stuff.
That's what I was going to say too, is I always see, like, your name popping up and stuff. I had Cody Carson in here and we were talking about his new album, and I think mm-hmm. he mentioned that you were at least a part of Skeleton.
Yeah, I did three songs on the new album.
Okay, cool.
With Cody, and then Bruce was one of them.
Yeah,
and with whoever. And Cody's just such an awesome dude that pretty much anytime he's like, we're working on a new Set It Off, I'm like, all right, let's go
do
write
it.
Some Set It Off songs, yeah.
I think Cody, what he said was that the name of the song, it was just named Skeleton because it was just like a skeleton track and there was nothing written to it. But then all of a sudden you guys were all like, oh, that's actually a kind of cool name for the song to turn into. So that led to what the theme of the whole song was, which was dope.
And kind of the album with all the skeletons.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny where the song started. It was me, Bruce, and Cam Walker. And
oh, nice.
I was with Bruce in person. We Cam zoomed in because he's with family. So Bruce showed me the outlining skeleton of the song when I got there, like the chord progression. Uh-huh. Like, what do you think of this sort of feel? I was like, this is great. Let's roll with this. And so he shows it and sends the audio file over to Cam, and it just says Skeleton on it. He goes, oh, I like this title. Okay, so what's it about? So we kind of worked, like, we had the song title first.
That was just because it was literally the skeleton of the track.
Yes, exactly.
We're like, all right, we're making a song about
it. And then we're like, okay, well, what could it be?
And then so the track that you guys just put out, you just put out Upgrade.
Upgrade, yep, with Dreamers.
And it has Dreamers on it. Mm-hmm. You dropped a video for it. And is this going to be a song off of the upcoming album?
Yeah, so it's essentially the first single on the album. And then, you know, we'll put out probably another song and then the album hopefully in June mm-hmm. is what I'm hearing. But I also don't even know. Like, it's like, I feel like I'm so
it's all business
stuff. Yeah, you know, there's been a couple, like, release dates. And
yeah.
I think we're, like, getting very close.
What's your musical history and past? And, like, what got you to the sound that Twin XL is? Because I feel like it's, like, it's a rock band, but I feel like some vintage vibes with it at times. And so what is your musical past?
I mean, I think that I've always gone back and listened to like Elvis Costello and
okay, wow.
stuff like that. I think inspires like that the vintage, I guess that kind of like throwbacky thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the core of it, I've just always written pop songs, you know,
mm-hmm.
and whether that's like, you know, sort of surrounded by punk rock guitars or synths, it's like, I think you could go back and listen to pretty much anything I've worked on and there's some sort of melodic similarity.
Oh yeah. And there. It's kind of blending. Just
yeah. And that's just
blend.
What, you know, I couldn't do it any different if I wanted to really. I mean, there's also like, you know, I loved Blink like so many other people. So like, there's always going to be that like, those like Tom DeLonge-esque melody.
Oh,
I'll sneak them in there.
Me and Tommy. So I threw this fact in with Jaden from WithCon when he was here. But Tommy in 2013, Blink had a contest that Tommy won, and it got him a lifetime supply of guest list spots on any Blink show. And
damn.
It was like you had to make a video using their lyrics. Is that what it was?
Hey, I'm Tommy. I suck at getting girls, so today I'm gonna see if Blink-182 lyrics can be used as pickup lines.
Hi.
Hi.
Is it cool if I hold your hand?
Not exactly.
And he won it.
And you won.
So he got a light. So he gets. He can go to any Blink show
damn.
If he wants. But that's my favorite band of all time. That's Tommy's favorite band of all time.
You got a plus one. All right. Well,
so suddenly you guys are friends now.
All right, well,
now
yeah,
who am I? I'm just
me.
Chopped liver because Tommy's got the Blink 182 hookup. What would your dream tour be? Blink 182 with Tom DeLonge. Who would your dream tour be as a musician?
I think they should bring back Tom and keep Skiba.
That's what I've heard people say.
Yeah.
I for me, it's just always been such a trio.
Yeah.
Blink 182. So it'd be
it would
hard.
It would be different.
It would be hard for me to accept that. But
yeah.
I do love Tom DeLonge. I'm waiting for that Boxcar Racer reunion, though.
I love that
I
album.
I loved Boxcar Racer.
It's a great album.
And that was a project that I feel like didn't even get to get off the ground much because they did have one album.
They did one album. They did like one tour or something.
Yeah. With The Used, if I remember correctly.
Yeah.
And I was little, and that was coming to Reno where I'm from. And I didn't go to that. That's like one show that I so regret not going to.
I remember I was supposed to go to see them at some like radio event in Connecticut where I'm from, and I got grounded for fucking up on my SATs.
Damn it, Cameron!
SSAT, one of them.
The PSAT?
Something that I didn't care about, and I just filled the bubbles in because I was like, this is stupid.
Dude, that was me all throughout
and then
school.
And then I couldn't go to see Boxcar. And I honestly, massive regret.
Oh yeah, I still regret to this day.
I guilt trip my mom about it. I'm like, you know, like that was the only chance to see this thing ever.
An iconic time in music history, and it's all your fault. Were you speaking of school and SATs? I was terrible on that stuff. Were you good in school?
No.
No. Oh, good. We're on the same page.
I think like pretty much like high school onwards, and I wasn't good in school before that either.
Mm-hmm.
But I was just like, I'm going to make music. Like,
mm-hmm.
That's what I'm going to do, and that you know, I don't know. Like I scooted on by, and I graduated high school and but at the bare minimum because even in high school I was playing in like three different bands and like
okay
you know,
so it's always been
yeah like every weekend I had some sort of show like I played in enough bands because you know local bands like you play like one show a month or something
I used to be in local bands
big,
I know
it's
that
a
game.
Big it's a big deal you're like oh hell yeah but I would just play I played drums
oh I didn't know you were a drummer
I
as well.
Started out as a drummer so in high school
what?
Like there's usually only like a couple drummers that are worth you know
anything
having and so I had been playing drums since I was like eight and I would just join everyone's band
mm-hmm.
so I was playing in like
you were
weird...
the drummer everyone's
yeah.
like yeah these guys featuring Cameron of course
yeah I would just I was like yeah like the resident drummer and I played in like a weird like hippie funk band and then I played in a pop punk band and I played in like a screamo band.
Oh, that was me.
So
I was
really
in screamo
had
bands growing up.
Yeah.
I got to show you my old stuff sometime.
Did you scream?
Oh yeah, I was the vocalist.
Oh fuck.
I screamed and sang my heart out. I was doing good cop, bad cop.
Damn.
I was both. We'll have
that
a local band night sometime and we'll show each other our old terrible music. Maybe yours was great.
It.
I don't know.
It's
maybe.
Not really. It's not.
You
it's
said like, that like with such fear.
I mean, yeah. I would show people like I don't know, like it's I listened back and like you just like you know I just feel
like,
I'm not
grown,
embarrassed by like
but you've grown definitely
yeah I listen back and I'm like man I you know but you know what it takes every step to get to where you're going no matter what you're doing so
oh yeah it's
I
all
always,
part of the journey
sometimes I like to listen back and like try to remember what I was thinking
uh-huh.
or even like just for writing songs like and maybe and honestly sometimes I wish I could get back to like the mentality of being like 16 in my room writing on just an acoustic guitar
because
mm-hmm. now you know, you go to the studio and there's the tracks happening at the same time as you're writing, and that's great, and you know, the songs end up amazing, but there's something like really genuine and really almost impossible to get back to about like the way you were before you really knew how to do it. It's like the same kind of thing as like listening back to like a band that you love and like their first record, and there's something special about it,
yeah.
And they, you 100%. Can never do it again because you get too smart about your craft, and like, you know, you get in a way mathematical, you know, like I know what works and what doesn't. And back then I didn't, but there was something beautiful about doing the wrong thing.
Just figuring it all out along the way. And that's what I always tell bands releases. And I've always been like, I don't know if it's because like they had all the time in their career to create the first album. And then after that, whether they got signed or something, then it's like, oh, we got to put stuff out every other year or something. So then they're cranking stuff out. But that's a good point. I feel like once you actually get more professionally involved in the music world, it kind of reshapes your understanding of creating music and just the whole process.
Yeah, you just it becomes more of a process and less of a feeling.
Uh-huh.
If you let it, you know, I think it. Sometimes you catch those like moments of just like, I don't know, whatever you want to call it, inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you also get to a point, or I feel like I'm at a point where I just, you know, I could literally be having the worst day ever and do my job, you know, writing for another artist. Like, I could, you know, get myself through it. Mm-hmm. Same as, like, any other job, really.
Oh, yeah.
But you definitely, I still get excited about those days where I get home and I, like, love what I did and I have a bounce of it and I'll, like, listen to it over and over and just be, like, laying in bed and I'm, like, I'm awesome. And then I wake up the next day and I get home and I'm like, I have no idea how to write songs. I'm horrible and I'm never gonna write a good song for the rest of my life.
And then the next day you write a great one.
And then the next one you write, yeah. So anyway, this is totally this is not an emotional roller coaster at all.
But it is. But it is.
Yeah.
Because I checked out the videos you guys put out. Mm-hmm. Well, I see them every time you drop them during the pandemic. And mm-hmm. what was the TV one? Was that Problematic?
That was Problematic.
That was a sick video.
That might be my favorite one. Runaway 17.
Soaked your tongue in kerosene. What was the idea behind that video? It's just like a never-ending loop of zooming out of TVs.
Yeah, never-ending loop of zooming out of TVs. And then I don't know if people really picked up on this, but you kind of do. Like, the longer it does it, every time you see us in the room, like, we're more, like, kind of
messed up.
And it was just kind of like a metaphor for, like, you know, feeling beaten down by, I think it was loosely about the song, but, like, also just feeling beaten down by the world. And we had this, me and John had the idea to get, like, messed up. And then Jade Ellers, who directed most of our videos, had the camera trick of the thing,
which was so cool. It made it so fun to watch,
and it was the three of us and Jade. We did the whole thing in his living room.
Every time you did it, did you guys play through the whole song with each look, or did you kind of have mapped out, all right, on this part of the song we know that the TV is going to be zoomed out here?
We played through the whole song, I think.
Every time?
I think so.
Whew, I guess that's any music video shoot day, though, is you just do the song over and over and over again.
But
I loved how that video turned out. And then the new one for Upgrade, it's you guys, you're in jail. There's some prison escaping from it.
Yeah.
Hit me with that video and how the collab came to be, because we actually didn't touch on that, on how you ended up getting Dreamers involved with it.
So Nick has been a friend of mine for
very
forever.
Very good first name.
And I've written a lot of a handful of Dreamers songs with him, and a couple of them have come out. So it's kind of the same thing as like with Cody. But I had the song and I showed him the song and he was like, I love this song. And I was like, do you want to just sing on it? And he tweaked a couple little things and kind of made it his own, but yeah, it just worked out. And then we did the video, and we tried to do some TikToks, you know.
And he's actually really good at TikTok. I did see the TikTok that you guys did where it took the Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg, the piano, and then played it to Upgrade, I think.
Yeah,
and I was like, we kind of made a
mashup. She says she need an upgrade, got some places to go, she need her own space to bring a new one home. Yeah, I mean, Nick is my neighbor. He actually lives like 4 minutes from me.
Oh, so you're in a good area. You're literally right around everybody, it sounds like. You got Jordan, you got Nick.
Yeah, I got all my friends around me, and it's awesome.
Popular.
What's
coming up with Twin XL? You guys have any tours or shows planned? It sounds like there's an album that will potentially
There's an album coming out this year. We did a show in Arizona. We did like a outdoor radio show type thing that this past, this maybe was the end of last year.
No, so you have done stuff since the pandemic. You've at least played that.
Yeah,
show,
I mean, we've been putting out music and doing stuff. And I think before the pandemic, we were on tour for like 2 years straight. And we were on tour with Fits in the Tantrums when the lockdown started.
Did that stop? Did that shut the tour down?
We only ended two shows short.
Oh, wow.
So it was kind of lucky timing wise. I mean, obviously people were the thing, you know, it's not like, you know, on that day, like COVID was like, here I am. But so, I mean, we didn't know, but yeah, we only got cut short two shows. And then basically we got home, you know, all of our friends were like, make sure you guys grab toilet paper on the drive home. And we were like, okay.
What are you talking
because
about?
Because here's the thing, like LA, like the panic started in LA before it started everywhere else.
And it started quick here. Yeah. Oh my God.
So we literally got like to LA and it looked like Gotham City or something. Like it was just like
an
chaos.
And the grocery stores were, I think the craziest thing was just the empty grocery stores.
Yeah.
It was so wild to see.
I mean, actually, here's a funny, not funny, but so we found out that happened. The last show, the day the tour got canceled, you know, last two shows got canceled, they had already set up the stage. The Fits had already set up the stage because we didn't know what was happening really. So they had set everything up. We got to the venue. Our green room had our whole rider. And then they were like, show's canceled. The world's shutting down. Everyone go home. And so I was like, I'm looking at our rider and I'm like, my friends are like, there's no food. There's no toilet paper. And I'm looking at our rider and I'm like, I'm taking all this shit with me. So I actually survived the first week
of lockdown
off of our rider.
Oh yeah, that's great.
I had like LaCroix, I had like a bottle of Tito's, I had you know, like a lunch meat tray, a veggie tray, and I was like thank God for our rider.
I had made like months before the pandemic, I made like a little comedy skit that took place in a hospital. So I like had all these medical supplies like gloves and masks.
Oh, cool.
And when everyone was running, like no one had masks or anything. Yeah.
I
was like, how much money you got? Because let me sling these. No, I didn't sell them. But that was like one thing too. Puberty, sorry. That was one thing too to where I was just like, wow, what are the odds of that? Like masks are the hottest thing to get right now. The hardest thing to get right now. And I had them. But luckily, it seems like the world's kind of opening.
Everything feels safer now for sure. And I think the vaccines are available. And
yeah, we're all getting them.
You know, we're all getting them. And everything feels better. I guess every day... you know, you just feel fortunate for the stuff that you used to take for granted, you know? Mm-hmm. At least that's how I feel. Like, even just being able to hang out with my friends and make music in the same room.
Yeah.
You know, doing, like, sessions. Because, like,
when it's not all over Zoom.
Yeah, and you know what? It became, like, second nature after a while. We did some of the Twin XL album was over Zoom.
Oh, really?
Just me, John, and Steven. Yeah. Actually, Upgrade was written over Zoom.
Oh, cool.
With this dude, David Pramick, and Eben Wares, and Charlie Snyder. That was, it was over Zoom. And then we went back and worked on it more, like, after the fact. But a lot of great music came out of that. But it was really, like, you feel like Groundhog's Day, waking up and then just staring
at
the screen.
Over and over.
Yeah, it was definitely weird.
And now, as you guys have new music coming out and at least one show lined up, I'm guessing more. The Somerset are back together now.
Somerset
though.
Are
That's
back.
Half of your damn band.
I know.
What's gonna is there gonna be a tour with you guys together where John and Steven are gonna double set it or like?
I would be super down.
That'd
for
be
that.
Sick.
Yeah,
that'd be sick.
I mean, I've known all those guys forever and girls forever, and they've always been great friends of mine, and I'm happy for them that they're kind of back at their home base doing the thing they grew up doing.
Because was Somerset, were they on hiatus at the time that Twin XL?
Yeah, they were
created?
On hiatus.
Okay.
And I think I think with a lot of people, like the pandemic, like we were saying, and I hate to keep talking about it, but like it kind of like makes you, it made you feel like, man, like whatever beef I had with this person, like why was that?
Mm-hmm.
I definitely had those conversations with a couple of people. Like,
I did
someone
too.
Would call me that I hadn't talked to in like 10 years, and they'd be like, "Hey man, like I'm really sorry about that thing that I did to you," and I don't even remember. but thanks for calling.
Yeah, that was rude. I literally did that to people. Even Tommy knows. I told Tommy, I was like, "Yeah, I just texted this person because a couple years ago I felt like a dick," and so I was like, I felt, and I don't know why, but that's weird to hear you even say that someone did that to you, because I was like, damn.
Yeah,
I
mean,
doing that
I think everyone had a nice long time of a year long of reflection.
Yeah.
But I'm stoked that they're back, and you know, we're definitely finding a balance so that when they're busy, I'll be busy writing.
And you can busy with writing and
I can keep
and
busy,
stuff,
yeah. And I think like anything else, I think when something's fun and you want to do it, that's the reason to do it.
Oh yeah.
And I think we have fun making the Twin XL music. We have fun playing the shows. So I think we're gonna keep doing it and kind of work around each other's
schedules.
Yeah, and John and Steven are writing constantly for other stuff. Jess is about to go on tour with Lights.
Yeah.
And everyone's just crushing it. Everyone's family at this point. And everyone's happy.
That's great. Mm-hmm. And so when I Google Twin XL, it's just nothing but mattress promos.
I know.
Were you inspired by mattresses for the name of this project?
Really, the only reason we called it Twin XL is because Queen was already taken.
So it is a bed pun.
It's a bad bed pun. You know, John just thought the name looked cool. He saw it. He saw like the word twin. And I don't really know. I think we just thought it looked cool.
Well, me, I'm a triplet. So I'm a little offended it's not Triplet XL, but we'll take care of that later.
Are you really a triplet?
I am.
Damn, I want to see you guys lined up.
We don't look anything alike. It's a boy and a girl.
Okay.
And me, which is a boy as well. They all live in Reno, which and you're from, where do you say you're from?
Connecticut.
What brought you out to LA? How long ago was that? I'm guessing
it was pretty much I started coming out here for Ready Set stuff and just staying at Jordan's all the time, and then I kind of fell into more writing, and then I just at some point I was here so much for either writing or playing that I was like, I just need to like move here, you know.
Makes sense.
It just kind of happened. Yeah, I didn't really come out here with any stuff either. Like, I didn't have to do like the drive out with the car. I just like had a suitcase and a guitar, and I was like, cool, I live here. I did like the whatever, you know, you find like one of those complexes at like Studio City or whatever. I did that.
That's where the first city I moved in was Studio City.
Yeah, I don't know why that is. It's like it's like pleasant.
And
part
I'm like a mile away from there now. I'm in Sherman Oaks.
I love this part of town. I moved to Echo Park just to like change the scenery.
Oh, is that where you are now?
Yeah.
Echo Park's great.
And Jordan's there, and I'm at his place so much, so it's like
it just makes sense to be that close. When you guys
I can sleep in a little longer.
Yeah. And then I make you get up early to come and do these chats.
Hey, I'm happy.
Hey, it was a good
Always
one.
Happy to.
I've loved Twin XL ever since it first kicked off, so I've loved to see you keep at it and putting out the videos. And next time, I'd love to film another show. I got to.
Yeah.
In LA at some point. I don't know what's going on at the Troubadour show that's coming up. But
if you want to come out and grab some
You
got to
see my
awesome
setup now. It's ridiculous.
Let's rip.
My camera is just too heavy. But it's great. It's like a little arm workout.
Hell yeah.
It's a little arm workout every time.
Is it
time.
Like a body cam?
So it's not, but it does have plenty on it. It's got handles and lights and mics and action. But
damn,
it only makes sense to do another video for you guys because...
So you might say that you had a bit of an upgrade.
Catch it now. The new track by Twin XL featuring Dreamers. That was a shout out. We'll end it there. No, but I'm glad all is well for you.
Thank you.
Anything
you
else
as well.
that is coming out, whether it's collabs you're working on. I saw that really weird smile video that you did. Could just forget,
so I smile till the bitter. Yeah,
that was strange. With who's it? Luna Aura.
Luna
is
Aura. It? Yeah, I just did a couple other songs on her EP.
Oh, sick.
She's rad. I mean, honestly, just follow my Instagram, and I pretty much all I'm posting is either Twin XL stuff or the music that I'm writing for other artists.
And I always see your name popping up with all that stuff.
Yeah, very, very fortunate to be involved with so many talented people.
Let's call that a wrap, everybody. Thanks for stopping by. I think we covered some ground.
I think we covered some ground.
I think we did some stuff.
I think we learned some things about each other.
Yeah, I think we did too. Most importantly, that neither of us got to see Boxcar Racer when they were touring, and we'll both blame our parents for it. My mom had nothing to do with it, but I'm going to blame Cameron's mom. So thanks for chatting, dude.